I'm in it not. Chiropractic 3 times a week for the last 3 weeks. So.
My back's all really tight and muscles. And even with biopsies, it's still like that's why I'm
going to scale. I'm going to put ice on it. Huh? 1 inch ice.
Oh, I didn't have ice when I bumped off.
Good morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. If we would all stand, greet one another, shake somebody's hand. Outside, but it's a beautiful day. We're here. It's another day that the Lord's made. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you for this day. Lord, help us. Help us to get out of the way. Put off the worries of the day, the things that are troubling us. And Lord, just help us to focus in on you this morning. We love you. We love you. We just want to give all the glory and honor to your name this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Here we go.
Jesus.
You may, if you wish, and I'm going to make you sit down if you wish. You want to remain standing? Who would that do?
Sigh.
last few times, you get so caught up in what you're doing that you forget. That we're going to take an offering. I mean, an offering is a very important thing. I think of Malachi 3:10, where it says, bring your offering to the storehouse, so that there might be food in my house. And this is what really gets me, where it says, test me on this. It's almost like I dare you to do this, because, you know, will I not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out blessings so much that you cannot even contain it? And I thought to myself, that is just wonderful. It made me think of the story of a poor widow that went to the temple. And Jesus is sitting there and he's looking out, watching all these people put their money into the churches, the temple's treasury. And, you know, a bunch of rich people dropping money in. And this poor widow woman walks up there and puts in two copper coins, a fraction of a penny. And he calls his disciples over and says, now look, this lady put in more than any of them. They're, I don't know. But, because I'm sure she knew the scripture of Malachi, you know. And it makes me wonder, you know, when she went home, you know, was her grocery sitting on the front porch? Because she gave everything she had to live on in that offering. And Jesus, being the Lord of the scriptures, I mean, he wrote it. He knew it. And maybe she's tested it before, that, you know, she knew God was going to take care of her. And, you know, you can only speculate, but the important thing is, God doesn't need our money. You know, he doesn't. He wants your heart. He wants your heart. And this is an opportunity, a privilege that we have to be able to come and give to the ministry of God. I mean, with this offering, we give to missionaries, we give to the community. So it is a privilege that we have to do this. So I'm going to ask the ushers to come, and we'll take up an offering. I'm sorry, rattled on a little bit too much, but it is important. And I know the last few times I get so proud of what I'm doing, I forget to say, "Oh, rattled on me." But it is the most important part to me of a worship service. So anyway.
Thank you. gracious and wonderful God, we thank you for all that you do to us, for the testing of our faith, for the challenging of our hearts to love you more, give to you more, God. We ask that you might use all that we have and all that we are for your glory. Amen. I'd like to offer this time for you to go ahead and share the peace of Christ with one another. Where you can feel yourself? Do you feel you can be yourself here? Who you are? Sometimes? Oh. Well, I hope this morning we're going to be talking about why church is important and why you should come to church. And one of the reasons is that it should be a place that, like, that you love and you feel comfortable at. That you be yourself, and yet at the same time challenges your faith to trust in God more by the love of everyone here and the love of God growing in you and in one another. So thinking of all those places, like your backyard and your home, what would it be like to feel that way here? What would you mean? More yourself, yeah. And the Bible. Okay. What would make you more comfortable if you were at home here? Just knowing that God loves you. Which God loves you in those places too, outside in your home. Yes. So, well, let us pray. Dear God,
remind me
of your love
and the importance
of fellowship
with one another.
Help me
to be at home
here in your presence.
Amen.
We have several announcements to go through this morning. We have a lot coming up with Lent quickly around the corner in just 2 weeks and roughly or so. So draw your attention to the first announcement that starting next Sunday, February 4th, at 12:30, Wesley will be offering a grief support group called Grief Share. It is a 13-week grief support study that takes place here on Sundays from 12:30 to 2 roughly. If you are interested, please let me or Jessica know, just because there's a workbook that goes with it, so we want to make sure we have enough material. That's the only reason that we need to know if you're interested in that. Ash Wednesday service will be here at Wesley with First Presbyterian Church on February 14th at 7 p.m. And then also our next Jackson concert series will be on February 17th at 4, which will be Warburg College Handbell Choir and Cantori.
Cantori,
I will get that at some point. Maybe next service, I'll pronounce that correctly. But it should be a wonderful time of hearing music as a performer variety of sacred music and handbell choir from Warburg College. So join us for that. Also, a big thank you to Jane and Mike Teestrait, as well as Greg Nancy Wall, and any of the others who helped with the soup supper and the dessert break for the Eagles and Ivories. There were lots of hours of preparation that went into that. It is an event that Wesley has fundraised for years, so we are grateful for all who continued the efforts for that as well. And then you'll see in your bulletin there is a pretty page that has like a heart about our Lenten midweek gatherings starting Wednesday, February 21st over at the Family Life Center. There is a sign-up sheet as well on the back if you are interested in joining for that, mostly so we have a count for the meal. But it should be a wonderful time of ecumenical gathering with other church people, other congregations that are listed there, in a time of food and worship and spending time setting apart the midweek to praise God and to set our hearts focused on God. So welcome to join in the wonderful excitement of the Lent season coming up quickly. Are there other announcements this morning?
Yes, Pastor Kiva, our fundraiser at Applebee's on February 20th has been canceled. They called me yesterday and said that their school asked for that month. They had a shooting and two people were killed there. And so they rescheduled us to April 9th, and I'll put a note again in the office so it will be permanent.
So the February 21 has been canceled, it'll be April 9th, but it sounds like all month it'll go for Perry.
Yes.
So it'll be wonderful still to go and
get
the support for that kind of thing. Any other announcements? If not, let us open our hearts and our minds to receive and to hear God's holy word this morning as we start with Hebrews chapter 10. Verses 19 through 25. So hear these words. Brothers and sisters, we have confidence that we enter the Holy of Holies by means of Jesus' blood, through a new and living way that he opened up for us through the curtain, which is his body. And we have a great high priest over God's house. Therefore, let's draw near with a genuine heart, with a certainty that our faith gives us. Sincere hearts are sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies are washed with pure water. Let's hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, because the one who made the promises is reliable. And let us consider each other carefully, for the purpose of sparking love and good deeds. Don't stop meeting together with other believers, which some people have gotten into the habit of doing. Instead, encourage each other, especially as you see the day is drawing near. And from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 41 through 52, we hear these words. Each year, his parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem according to their custom. After the festival was over, they were returning home, but the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents didn't know it. Supposing that he was among their band of travelers, they journeyed on for a whole day while looking for him among their family and friends. When they didn't find Jesus, they returned to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple. He was sitting among the teachers, listening to them and putting questions to them. Everyone who heard him was amazed by his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were shocked. His mother said, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Listen, your father and I have been worried. We've been looking for you." Jesus replied, "Why were you looking for me? Didn't you know that it was necessary for me to be in my father's house?" But they didn't understand what he had said to them. Jesus went down to Nazareth with
with them
and was obedient to them. His mother cherished every word in her heart, as Jesus matured in wisdom and years and in favor with God and with people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. God, it is your word that has been written, be placed upon our hearts and in our minds. Let us hear your words. Let the words that I speak be words of conviction, of comfort, of hope, and of joy as they draw us closer to you, Lord. Amen. There's kind of an old story that was told among two pastors who were meeting together. One, a younger one, and his older mentor pastor had been in the pulpit for several years. And the younger one had this devastating problem that he thought he should bring his mentor. He said, "Look, I don't know what to do about it, but we have a bat problem. We've tried trapping them, we've tried closing the entrances. It's never ending. The bats just keep coming into the church. What do I do about this?" So the older pastor said, "Well, we have dealt with this problem and we've eliminated all bats and haven't had a problem for years. And all we did was we welcomed them into the church, we baptized them, and we made them members and haven't seen them since." In all reality, it does seem to be at times the trend of the church. Go through the phases of baptism and confirmation and membership, and sometimes never interact into the same doors that you were once in your childhood, grew up in. Or you thought you could become a member, and then that was the end of the story, never coming back in to church to be renewed and to be refreshed. As we continue our sermon series about you, ask the question this week was, why church? The question was, having family members who live good lives, they relatively seem like they're good people, they're good Christians, but they don't feel there is a need for church. And I think of that as a growing understanding in our culture. If you look at statistic-wise, the amount of people that enter into a church each day is shrinking rapidly. In fact, not even just going into a church, but people who even profess a faith or religion, that number is growing rapidly, but they do not have a faith or religion. And part of this challenge that we have is, for some, church is just another activity on the list to come back with everything else going on Sunday mornings. But I've been doing this for over 10 years now, and one thing I have learned is it doesn't matter what day of the week we have church. I've had church on Saturday nights. I've had church in the middle of the week. I've had church Sunday morning. It doesn't make your numbers increase because you change the day of the week to fit the schedules that others around you have. So why is church important? Our scriptures tell us, especially in Hebrews, do not stop meeting with one another and other believers as some believers have done doing. When this was written, Christians weren't gathering as much as they had started. If you read through the book of Acts, when the early church started, Christians gathered together at homes. They had fellowship regularly with one another. They prayed for one another. They grew in multitudes because of their faith and their belief in God and their prayer. And then we get to this section in Hebrews, and they weren't doing that. They weren't gathering maybe as frequently. They weren't getting together and praying as often as they should. And they needed to get back together, to gather together as believers, to pray, to worship, and be in communion with one another. Yes, church is necessary to be specifically in person with other believers for many other reasons. One, to worship God, to grow your faith in God, but also to grow that second part of that commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. If you don't see your neighbor, if you don't see the one next to you that you disagree with on everything, then how are you going to grow in your love for that neighbor? Coming together in church, in person, is an important part of our faith as Christians. It was when the believers gathered together, when they were in person, when they worshiped together and prayed together, that the church was growing. It was growing rapidly because of their faith and their strong belief in God, and because they had to learn to love one another, even in the midst of different opinions and different views. They had to learn to love each other in the midst of their brokenness, to be a place where all can gather and be themselves. I put a kind of a poll out on Facebook a few weeks ago, and I asked the question, why do you go to church, or why don't you go to church? And unfortunately, unfortunately, it wasn't really a super helpful poll in that all the people who answered it, I already knew were Christians and either had reasons that they went regularly or didn't. But what I found most interesting is a couple of the comments were the reasons they didn't go to church regularly was because their children were not welcomed. They felt that some of the church looked down at their children or pushed them out of the way because they were an inconvenience. And I remember in one of the churches I served early on in my ministry, part of the ministerial group I was with there, there was this conversation about one of the pastors in town, wonderful person, but their challenge was if a baby was crying in the middle of a sermon, they would just like call out the parent to touch the child. And their congregation was devastated. They felt it was very unwelcoming and not a very kind and loving thing to do. So I found that this is a response that is pretty accurate in some churches, not just by pastors, but sometimes children are kind of distracting. They're wonderful, they're brave, but if they're running up and down the aisle, they're crying, people don't tend to filter sometimes what they say about it. So these comments, there are a couple of friends of mine, and I know their little ones are probably just as young as mine, were just frustrated that they felt they couldn't come to church because their kids were the blunt of the emotion and of the conflict of each time they attended. That would be a wonderful reason not to go to church. I would agree that you would not want to go somewhere that was toxic for your children to go to. But another reason that somebody put as to why they didn't go to church was that they didn't want to have to get up by themselves to get all of the children ready to go. Which my husband does that on Sunday mornings since I'm here. He does a wonderful job of it. We take turns during the week. But it was more of as if it was a reason that they had told themselves, I can't do this every week after week. Maybe once in a while, yes, the emotions of doing that is chaotic and crazy. But week after week, they had convinced themselves, I just can't go to church. It's too much work. And I'm trying to validate and understand and say that these are true and wonderful reasons that people are struggling with. That how as a church can be welcome and say, look, your children are loved here. How can we help you get here on Sunday morning? How can we make it easier so that you don't feel the burden and the weight of it? Church should not feel like a burden or something hard to handle. It should be a place of home, a place where you come in and you feel sanctuary and rest. Churches for years used to be a sanctuary. Come out of the storm, come and rest and connect your heart back to God where it would be. But because of the shrinking of churches and the fear that we're going to not have enough numbers to keep our doors open, churches have tried heavy programming, another activity to try to get the interest of people here. But that's not proven to work either. What has shown in Scripture is words of Jesus, didn't you know I'd be in my Father's house? Of Christians gathering together to pray and to worship God, prayer and their time of worship grew in numbers together because they learned to love one another in the midst of anything going on in their lives, whether it was suffering, whether it was chaos. One of the traditions of the Wesleyan movement was doing exactly this. They would gather together in small groups. John Wesley and Charles Wesley and some of their close friends began to gather together in small groups regularly. And they didn't just gather and worship, but they gathered and they talked to one another and asked, how is it with your soul? What have you done this week that has drawn you away from God? So yes, they'd ask about their deepest sin or their regret for the week. And then as a group, they'd say, how can we help you? How can we help make this week grow you closer to God and not away from God? And they became so intimate in their relationships and love, they weren't afraid to ask the hard questions. They weren't afraid to have conversations of disagreements. They found the grace in the midst of it. And it grew. This movement grew because there was a love there genuinely different than the outside. A love that was on a foundation of Christ's love that didn't falter away when things got challenging or hard, but it bound together in unity and a relationship stronger than knowing the world. Here in our culture, it's so politicalized and polarized, we even come together with heaviness, holding on our thoughts and our opinions so heavily because we're afraid that we aren't going to be heard. I think there's a great rooted fear in our world. We're fearful that we aren't heard, that our thoughts aren't heard, that our emotions aren't heard, and we we take that into everything as like a fight. Like, I can't share this, or it's going to cause great disruption, or if I share this and they disagree, I'm going to be upset because I don't want to disagree. But the church is a place of disagreement. It should be a place of unity, to gather together, to worship God and to love, and to lay it all down. A cuter story for you this week. I'm wonderfully blessed by this, but Carson has been really into church since day one, because we bring him to church every single week after week, and it's challenging when your mom's a pastor, but lately he's been building with blocks, and the other day he built a church with mega blocks. All alone, he's like, Mom, you have to come see what I built. So I come to his room, and he was like, it's a church. And it did look like a church. It was very sweet. But not only did he build a church, he had those in attendance of worship in church. They were, of course, cute characters like Paw Patrol. He had Owlette from PJ Masks, and Mario was in there. But he was so excited to share with me his love of church that he didn't just create this art. He created a place where he feels is a part of his life, a place of welcoming, a place of hope and love, because he's been raised in that environment. And we've been very blessed that so far the churches we've served have welcomed the children in. The appointment before this, there wasn't any nursery, and so I've had sermons where Carson, at 2 years old, would run in between my legs in the middle of a service and run around and do chaotic things, and I just kept going, but nobody had a problem. They welcomed, and they loved them, and they continue to love them, and that's why we go to church. To continue to be that love separate from the world when things annoy us in the world, we can bring that here, and we can know that people hear your emotions, they hear your thoughts, and they come in solidarity to understand or to have grace in the midst of it. Church may not seem necessary anymore in our culture, but we're missing out on that connectional relationship. You can't get that when you're at home watching it on the screen. Like, COVID happened, it was a great way still to connect to God, but you weren't connecting to one another. It's the second part of that commandment. Love the Lord your God with your heart, grow in your faith, but grow in relationship to your neighbor in the same amount of love. Church gives you that opportunity. If you're not worshiping church with one another, if you're not worshiping with your enemy, how are you going to grow to love your enemy more? That's why we have church. And whoever submitted this question, it might not be the answer they're looking for somebody who isn't attending church, but the reality is, unless we get to a culture that understands that church is not just another activity, it is a place where we meet God and God's love is made known, then nothing is going to change until we understand that that is the foundation of why we gather together. So God's love is made known to us and one another, in our relationships, in how we go about our days and our lives. One of the comments of why people do go to church, they were wonderful. One was, I go to church because I feel like the rest of my week is not right without it. That it sets me in the right mind frame and it prepares me for the week ahead when I go to church. My mind is focused upon God and I feel better throughout the week. Others, wonderful comments about why going to church, it is that relationship. It's about building and being connected to God in worship, in song, in praise, but also seeing friends and those who you have come to know in your relationship with God, who you've come to love. Maybe you don't really love them yet, but you're going to. You're going to keep coming week after week, and you're going to keep building on that love, because church is where we're meant to be. As Jesus says, didn't he know I was in my Father's house? Like, it was the most obvious thing to Jesus, and Mary and Joseph were worried parents. But to Jesus, didn't you know that's where I would be? We should be in our Father's house. We should be in the church where we can gather together and worship the Lord. Why go to church? We don't go to church for ourselves. We go because God loves us and calls us to grow a relationship with God and one another. But sometimes we go for ourselves. Sometimes we need that strength in the week. Sometimes we need to know that I can be myself here and everyone is okay with that. They're not going to kick you out because you're yourself. They're not going to be upset with your kids because they're being kids. A church is a place where we belong and we are loved by God. That's where we go. What better place can you learn about the love of God? You don't get that in the culture. You don't get that in the stores. You don't get that anywhere else around you, because you get constant chaos. And in the church, you get love in the midst of the chaos. And it's beautiful. It's not perfect. There's mixed things going on. But chaos can be perfect and beautiful when it's surrounded by God's love and grace in the midst of it. So let us pray. God, we love you, and we love that you are with us in every moment. But God, we know that we fail to connect to you. We fail to connect in prayer, we fail to connect in our relationships with one another, God. And God, we oftentimes place you on a schedule or on some sort of pedestal of, if I have time for that, I'll do that, or I'll go this week. But God, we ask that you might change our hearts. Let us know that the connection to you is what gives us life. It gives us the breath in our lungs. It gives us hope and the ability to love others more. Now, don't let us fall away from that, no matter what. But may we continue to grow in you, in our love for one another, to come and gather with other believers, to share in fellowship with one another, God, and be changed by your perfect and wonderful love. And God, we pray this morning for all who are struggling with emotions, struggling with pain and suffering of chaos, God, or even struggling with the unknown. We know that you are God filled with strength and love and are in the midst of all of those things. And God, if those here are filled with hope and joy and are not struggling, again, you're in the midst of that. It is you that bring the joy upon our lips and the cries upon our hearts come from cries of hurt that you understand, God. God, we lay this at your feet, knowing that you are with us in every moment, and you build us up, giving us a love beyond anything we could do on our own. God, we also join together today, sharing in unity the same prayer that your Son, Jesus, taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us join together and confess as one what we believe in our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let's all stand. Song, isn't it, to rev you up? If you don't get wrapped up on this one. Somebody needs to check the pulse. So let's sing this song.
Let the songs of the Lord.
To inspire one another to love the same Lord. Amen.